Happy Monday. Can I just tell you, like, we're 1 week away from like a really big moment in time, and I'm excited.
Tell us.
The world changed 12 months ago, right now.
Yes.
Like, we lived the first 6 months of last year on fire. You know, the business and the interest rates were a lot lower, and life just felt differently. And then the world changed. And when the world changes, it takes us a while to get used to it. But I think we're pretty much used to it at this point. And I feel like consumers are pretty much getting used to it. Yet, I like to compare. And it's really hard to compare a March in 2023 when we had 6.5% interest rates to March 2022, when the rates were 3. They wasn't even comparable, right? So what's exciting to me is starting in July, everything will be comparable again. Mm-hmm. And then we can kind of actually tell, hey, am I doing good? Am I winning? Have I moved my business forward from a year ago? All those conversations. What do you think about?
100% agree. Quite honestly, I think there's a natural seasonality anyway. You still have people that are closing July, going into that you started working a few months ago. It's kind of we're in that little in between zone, but personally, my favorite quarters of the year is third and fourth quarter. It is a natural time of the year to lead generate. And so it would be cool to see if similar markets, is it the market that's changing my business or is it my activities that's changing my business? Because I love that we're going to be very similar. And quite honestly, I think third and fourth quarter are the best times to lead generate.
Like, honestly, an agent could have been doing really well in May, mm-hmm. but feel like they're losing because they're comparing it to last May. But in all honesty, they were doing really, really good. They just couldn't mm-hmm. see it because of the comparison, right? Like, I hate saying we live in a comparison society, but in business, you do compare yourself to previous performance, right?
Mm-hmm. And some of that's healthy. Some of that's a healthy thing. It's just, let's put it in context. And so now we have a context of similar year over year. And with one exception, and I think we're going to talk about it today, is inventory slightly down a little bit from last year, but not, not tons, but it's still. But then again, really a conversation. Is it the market's inventory down or is it my inventory down? Because if I get my inventory up, it doesn't really matter as much. I'm not as affected by the market. And if I personalize it like that, going, how's my inventory? If it's 10 houses I want to have listed at all times, and I know that's the number I need to meet to hit my goals, then my business is doing great.
Yep.
Or whatever your listing number is. So.
Of course. All right. Well, let me pull some numbers up here just to kind of accentuate our conversation for a second. Sure. So this is home sales in FMLS. Blue was 2022 and orange is 2023. And it's not even a comparable game. However, you can see this line right here between June and July is when the world changed. So now we're playing this game going forward. So mm-hmm. I'm curious to see where we land in June. I'm expecting us to hopefully be up around this 8,000 unit number in the month of June. It feels that way. And I hate going on feeling, but it certainly feels like we're moving inventory right now. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. We'll see what the second half of the year looks like, but it'll be exciting. And, one of the things that it's a game we can win. I don't feel like we could win the first half of the year. Now we're playing a game we can win. And I'm excited about it. All right. So what do the numbers look like? So here's Fulton County. Right now there's 726 active inventory, 133 under contract, 301 pending if my eyes don't fail me, and 282 in the closing category. If I break this down just to this year and ignore the dip because it goes down to zero at the end, because that's just how the graph's done. Are we up, down? It sure looks like inventory's up, the pink line. The under contract line looks healthy. It doesn't look like it's got a lot of peaks and valleys. We certainly were a little bit higher in May than we're looking right now. However, I think that was a last minute get it before the rates kept going up kind of pop. But at the end of the day, I mean, that number is a pretty consistent number, which says agents are out there selling houses every week. And then if you jump to the blue line on the pending, we've certainly gone up from a seasonality perspective. May seemed to be a little bit higher. So maybe my June 8,000 is a little bit of a stretch just looking at Fulton County here. But for the most part, we're up, right? And the one that matters the most is that brown line, which are the closings. And right now, last week, we had 282. The week before that, we had 404. The week before that, we had 265. And this is Fulton County. So up from 134 up to 400, we're on that upward trajectory, right? Anything you'd add?
I would just say it's seasonality. Like May and June are traditionally our biggest closing months, which also put May as a big pending month. So we're in, which is great. I love traditional seasonality to things. So,
yep. All right, let's jump over to DeKalb. And well, the spinning wheel here. Here we go. Dun, dun, dun. Don't you love just waiting on computers? All right, same conversation. Look how all over the place DeKalb County is. And if I stretch it to just this year, DeKalb bounces around a lot more than Fulton. And obviously, the smaller the county, the more it's going to bounce around. But at the end of this conversation, we started the year with about 175 active listings. And right now there's 388. That's a giant increase. I'm sorry, 288 to 388. So it's 100 active inventory property more right now in the middle of the summer than we had at the beginning of the year, which doesn't sound like a lot. But remember, normally we're low in the summertime in inventory because we're selling it all out, where that inventory pops in February, March, and then we dip because it's the velocity of the summer is faster than other times. So interestingly, 91 active under contract. In the green line, you definitely see a little more trend on the upward level, like more houses are selling into DeKalb on a weekly basis going under contract now versus the first of the year. On the pending, you can see that upward trajectory as well, seasonality, and then closings. God, their closings are all over the books. You know, anytime we go over 200 in a weekly total, it's a big number for DeKalb County. Last week we had 221. The week before that was 205, and then this week we dropped to 172. But my guess is most people are closing their properties this week.
I would agree, and we see that in the office. Most of our closings are this week, and I kind of look at that little dip. That looks like Memorial weekend. You know, those are, you know, there's some like holiday weekends and people's, you know, summer vacation that first week of June. So
100%. You know, and I mean, we live in a calendared society. So we just got out of Juneteenth. Well, that's all of a sudden a new 3-day weekend for a lot of people. And does that disrupt the real estate sales? It probably does a little bit because, you know, a lot of people, they have an extra day on a weekend. They go to the beach or they do something and they don't go look at real estate. Let's look at Cobb County real quick. Let's go here. All right. So this week there was 381 in the active inventory column. 105 under contract, 209 pending, and 204 closed. If I take my cursor away, inventory looks kind of stable there. Like it goes up to 400, down to 300, up to 400. And then active under contract started low, and then it's kind of hovered around 100 every week. And then the pending number started low, went up, and it's kind of, if I drew it out, maybe it's a little bit of an incline, but it looks pretty consistent to me. Mm-hmm. And then, but closings looks like it has an incline to it from a seasonality perspective.
Yeah.
That just makes you feel good, like the market's going. And if I'm a real estate agent and I'm looking at this, what should I be looking at? I think just on a giant scale, people are buying and selling real estate, and I need to see that inside these numbers. Mm-hmm. One, two, I think seasonality is something I should see. But what do you think we should be looking at and paying attention to?
I think they're kind of, all these lines are relatively trekking with each other. So if it is active, the pending is, for the most part, they're trekking. They're with each other. And I think the truth is, it really comes back down to, if there's homes that are selling, why not me? Like, why am I not going out there grabbing my fair share? And that should just be like the constant conversation, internal conversation, is like, how am I grabbing my fair share? Because they're selling.
So they are selling. And another thing I think is kind of funny, if we like to poke fun at ourselves, agents are actually having to sell the house again.
Yeah.
So they're calling for feedback, going, hey, you didn't give me any feedback on that showing, which you didn't call for feedback a year ago. Like, it just, you held on. And now they're like, hey, what's the feedback? Is there anything you could change? You know, that the game of sales is back on.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a skill set, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
I mean, the joke of the four P's or whatever, price, position, put it in the MLS, right? Like, put and a sign pray. In the yard. that actually worked a year ago. It doesn't work now. Like, you actually have to market a property. You have to position a property. You've got to take constructive feedback and make suggestions and be skilled to have a conversation with a seller on, hey, we're getting bad feedback on your blue shag carpet. Let's talk about changing.
Right. Like, right. I mean, quite honestly, you have just having that conversation, like, as you have that listing appointment and getting that listing agreement signed and not waiting for it to go on the market. But with that said, I'm agreement with you. The skill of selling is back, which to me, it means everybody has the opportunity to sharpen your skills.
Yeah. You know, we're going to do a state of the Atlanta real estate market here in a couple of weeks in July, after we get all the numbers from June. And I think what'll be interesting is the days on market effect. Like, we don't track that on a week to week basis. We track it on a monthly basis, but my guess is that conversation we're having around actually having to sell houses is because there's a lot of conversations going on between sellers and agents, or agents to agents, that they're not used to, or they've forgotten, mm-hmm. or whatever. And it's something we got to all up our game around. Right.
Yeah. I mean, we have the conversation at the office often how buyers are remaining pickier, even though inventory is lower than it was pre-pandemic levels. But when they're paying at a peak price with a somewhat higher interest rate, they're pickier, and understandably so. So it's understanding both it's a good opportunity really for both people, but you got to understand a buyer mindset when you go to list. And you have to understand how to position the home within the market as a good listing advisors. But then at the same time, the buyer has an opportunity, perhaps if it's not perfectly done, to negotiate. And yet at the same time, if it's perfectly done, they may have to go hurry up and make an offer and bid against it. So it's definitely the conversation. Buyers are a little pickier. Sellers can't take everything unless their home is darn perfect.
100%. Well, let's jump over to something else. So this study was a study the National Association of Realtors did. It actually was done in May of 2022. So it's actually a year old, yet I promise you these numbers are pretty relevant today. So if I jump down here to this chart, it says Texas, Georgia, Oklahoma, and Alabama had the highest fraction of purchases by institutional buyers. Now, I do think more of this is going on the further out from the city you are. I don't know that a lot of it happens inner city. Yet this stat says 19% of the properties bought in 2021 in the state of Georgia went to institutional buyers. So the question behind the stat that I'm asking myself is, what are they buying? Because I don't think they're buying the listings out of the MLS. What are they buying?
I think, I mean, they may get a few from the MLS, but it's all these guaranteed offer MOFR pitches that they're going direct. They're bypassing the real estate agent, going direct to the consumer. And I think, and I'm sitting there going, why in the South? Because versus California or Washington or New York and all these things. Well, we're relatively affordable still as a region compared nationally, certainly compared to California and Washington, Oregon, and certainly compared to like the New Yorks and New Jerseys. So they could still rent, or they could do something. They could have a little more margin to flip. And I think they're going direct to the consumer, bypassing the agent, and it makes sense to target our area because of affordability compared to nationally.
Yeah. So if you went back 5 years, those houses would have gone through the MLS. They would have been bought through the MLS. Now we don't even know they're happening. They're not even on the radar, meaning Open Door buys a house and sells it to an institutional investor. A bank has a package of 10 houses and just offloads it to an institutional investor, where 10 years ago, there were REO agents that would list those houses. They're not listing them now. They're just selling them to these institutional investors. So the reason I think this is important, and remember, this industry update is all the good, bad, and the ugly. Like, we're not here to fluff it. The reason I think this is important is this is a part of our industry we got to learn how to navigate. And we brought the iFinder product to the heart of Atlanta last week. And it was first time we introduced it. If you missed it, you certainly can still get certified. I think they certify once a month online. But do you have a solution if a homeowner is saying, hey, I'm interested in what I could just get a cash offer without going to the MLS? Do you have that tool in your toolbox? You know, it just is an awareness factor. If I jump back to this slide, it says institutional buyer market share rose to 13% in 2021. I would venture to say it probably was around there in 22 and probably dipped at the second half, but it's back. Interesting, it, no?
Yeah, it's interesting. And it's something I think we get to, it's like, it's because it's like iBuyer was like a dirty word, like a pre-pandemic little, you know, we, you know, it's like, oh, I don't even want to show some of their homes because they are bad. But the truth is, if we make it a dirty word, we never address the reality of what we're working with in the market. And I love the fact that at the Heart of the Land Group with the iFinder program, we're actually trying to get ahead of it so our agents can actually win and our own investors can win in this process. So, but I think it's, we can't ignore it. We just got to do it.
We got a question in the chat said, do we know where these properties are and what's the average price point? You know, an institutional buyer, you got to understand their thinking. So one is they want affordable. And they want to be able to sit behind a computer screen and value a property and know that the properties around it are comparable. So where you find that is in most suburbs of metropolitan areas, because they're mostly master plan communities. I can tell you the 10 houses left of me and the 10 houses right of me are going to compare out the same. You know, they want to be able to value a property digitally, one, and two, they have certain buy boxes. And what I mean by that is, they don't want to go to the $1 million plus properties, although I've seen them do it. They want the bread and butter like we all do, right? Like the ones that are easy to flip, easy to hold, easy to rent, all that stuff.
Which is your first time home buyer price points. Maybe you're coming from the condo to the first home move up. It's, you know, which is that whole thing we keep talking about, the shrinking inventory of your first time middle class home buying volume of homes. Yeah. So
Mark put Open Doors sold 453 million homes in 22. And year to date, they've already sold 343 million, 100 million less than they did all last year in the first half of the year. That, I mean, this is a big deal. And I love him or hate him, Mark Spain drives a lot of that Open Door business. So you certainly understand if you live in the city of Atlanta, you can't not see the billboards. But the reality is, how do we compete? What tools are we bringing to the table? What scripts and dialogues are your team leaders teaching us in our team meetings to compete with this segment of the market? And I don't, like I said, I'm not saying it, the world's falling apart. We're talking, this says 13%, this says 19%. So my guess is this is the national average and these are specific averages. So we're more of a hotbed than most of the country. But at the end of the day, this is not a segment of the market you need to ignore or turn your nose up to spite your face around. Is that even the right saying? We're going to move on.
Yeah, it's close enough. You got it.
Builders are back on track.
Yeah.
I agree with this. I don't always agree with all the headlines. I think builders, through the supply chain issues, through the interest rates, like we all did, slim down. On here it says they made a lot of layoffs, but they figured it out. And contrary to 2008, when builders just panicked and pulled out of the market and stopped building, I think the builders slowed down. I don't even think they pushed pause. They figured it out and they're full steam ahead. And I think this is a good sign for us. If you go to the Atlanta Business Chronicle, it says home building starts to pick back up as buyers adjust to new pricing norms in tight market. So, I mean, this says build new construction is going to be a big part of our future, and you should be paying attention to that. Builders, I mean, go ahead, Kelly.
I was going to say it makes sense because the cost of materials have come down. Concrete's still high, but your lumber is down, your other materials down. Most things are no longer sitting at the port in Los Angeles or somewhere. They're actually got off the container ships. They're coming in. I felt like a lot of buyers, especially those who lived through that great recession in 08, they held on to dirt. Like I could name in so many neighborhoods and town neighborhoods of the builders that I'm aware of that they would have started the build, but they held on to it until they felt it was a little bit better to actually start tearing down, constructing. They may have had to pay taxes, property taxes on a building that's about to be a tear down, or maybe they tore it down and left it vacant. So, but then going into these bigger subdivisions and so forth, I think they've learned how to manage their costs. And I think the builders are having to always think like a year plus out, you know, with the interest rates stabilizing, the predictability of the finding of the cost of product, they are feeling relatively good because they know inventory is still low. So they still have opportunity to sell versus 08 when inventory was increasing, even amongst the resale population. And so I completely understand their confidence and I actually support it. And I think it's cool.
So. Absolutely. This is an interesting graph. you know, you see the housing market index is the dark blue, single family sales is the medium blue, and single family sales next 6 months. Assuming that's inventory on the ground being built, right? And then, but the one that I like is this, the light gray one, which says traffic of prospective buyers. So very rarely do you get insights in how many people are walking into new construction, right? But you can see in June 2022, they gave it a rating of 48, whatever the 48 means. It's not necessary, but they tanked in November and December. It's so winter. Did our buyers. But in June 2023, it's showing it at 37. Now, remember my comment at the beginning of this call, like we're now comparing starting in July, apples to apples. So I can't compare this 37 of June 23 to this 48 of June last year, but I will be able to compare July 22, 37 to wherever July 23 shows up. And my guess is it's going to be higher.
Mm-hmm.
So all of a sudden, like we have some really good data that we're going to be able to talk about going forward. Not that we didn't have good data before, it just wasn't happy data. At least now we'll be able to tell if we're better and getting better. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that this graph is talking single family homes even more than the multifamily homes, because we chatted on this in our team meeting a couple of weeks ago too. Travis, who's our commercial real estate agent in our office, about how financing is tightening for your big like commercial, your multifamily, your apartment complex, et cetera, et cetera. But this being speaking to single family homes, my goodness, we still have so much demand. And I think that's, yeah, I completely see the confidence in the single family home for purchase. So
yep,
the money's available. That's the thing. If they've kept it, there's so much money available for those who need capital.
Yep. I'm going to hit this article fast so we don't run out of time, but the I'm putting it in the chat. This video is a really good video. I would encourage everybody to go watch. But the concept of this article is 5 reasons you don't have listing-based real estate business yet. You don't have enough market knowledge. They lack a unique selling proposition. They don't have a marketing plan. But the points I want to drive home are number 4. Is they lack a focus on listings, and they don't have a geographical farm area, which I actually think is kind of a subset of this one. But Kelly, I'll tell you my thoughts and then you can comment. You know, Keller Williams, we talk about leads, listings, and then leverage. But really what that means is you got to get into the industry and figure out your lead format, your lead generation machine. But lead generation, just in a generic sense, doesn't specifically focus on listings. It doesn't mean it won't bring you a listing. It just means it's not focused on listings. And one of the hard leaps in real estate as you're growing up is to figure out how to become a listing agent. And my advice to people is you got to put a flag in the ground. And what I mean by that is not specifically dirt, but you've got to pick a target group of something that you have something in alignment with, whether it's a church group, a political group, a neighborhood, an alumni group, whatever you want to choose as a group of people that you have something in alignment with that you can become the expert of. And when you make that choice, you start marketing accordingly to where you're the seasoned expert inside that target group. Geographical farm is one of the easiest ways to explain the conversation, but it's not the only way. But to really become a strong, strong listing agent, you've got to have a group of people that think of you as the market expert to their group that they belong in. And there's 1,000 ways to cut that conversation up. But what I see most agents struggling with, even agents that have been in the business for years that just don't have a really strong listing business, is because they've never actually created a focus around being an expert in some target area. What would you say?
I 100% agree with that. And I think it becomes very easy. Most people often they start their business, it's easy to pick up a buyer. They're at open houses, you can convert them, you get an internet lead, you get a signed call, you show up somewhere, someone wants to buy. Sellers take a skilled dialogue and conversation, and they value competency over likability. Buyers like likability. They want to like you when they work with you. They want you to be competent, but when it comes to being a listing agent, competency is more important than your likability. And they want to know that. And what I actually think too, then we get in the habit of doing the same thing over and over again. So all of our TikTok videos are about, hey, buy this house versus like, look at my marketing strategies and our language and around how we promote ourselves needs to change if we want to let people know that we know how to position homes within a market, how to get them sold. And it also takes a huge skill in truly digging into their motivation, what their pain points are in selling, because it's everybody wants the highest price, fastest sale, but there's something else they want too. And so it's a lot of conversations, and that's the next leap. I'm in agreement with you. I think we can get really fat and happy because we can get a lot of buyers, still make good money. But if we want a sustainable, long-term, lifestyle-rich business, we have to get into a listing game. And if we can get, like we've been talking about this at the Buckhead office, getting out of the mindset of going, we realize it's not an interest rate problem we have. It's an inventory problem. But if we kept on saying, hey, it's a market inventory problem, it's almost like it's someone else's fault. But if I go, okay, it's my inventory problem, then it's now my responsibility to go find off-market listings, to find my listings, to talk to my database about selling, why it's a good time to sell, and, you know, do the math for them. Who cares what the interest rate is? If there's a great compelling reason to sell, there's a great compelling reason to sell. And so making it a little more, if you want to be a great listing agent, you have to make it personal that it's my inventory and not, oh, the market has low inventory. No. That may be true. I can go get as much inventory as I want and great not push it on someone else.
Listen, this is something I would encourage all of you to take back to your offices and have more dialogue around. I'm happy to take any call, but we start and end on time. So I love you guys. Yes. Happy Monday. Bye.
Yep. Happy 4th, y'all.
You're welcome.